We have a super fan in our midst.
What's the... Come on, I couldn't come empty.
Oh my gosh, that is amazing.
This one's
amazing.
For you. This one's for you.
Oh my goodness.
I got you one too.
Yeah.
You got your own merch line. You guys are big now. You guys are big now.
Oh my gosh. Hello everyone. We are live from the 2025 European Mainframe Technical Exchange. It's quite an exciting venue here at the Hilton in Prague. Obviously, it's a great opportunity for us to meet with customers. We have about 150 customers here and quite a few Broadcom folks. So it's a great opportunity for us to find out what our customers are doing and obviously talk to them about their problems and how our solutions necessarily fill some gaps. Now for us in What's Up Mainframe, it's an opportunity to interview some of the great people that we work with who are based in the US, because a lot of them have come over here. And I'm excited to introduce Cody Giardinello. And we're gonna learn a little bit about, from him about, yes, the products he's connected with, but also some of the efforts he's trying to do for his team to kind of get them to be able to work better and more efficiently, even using our DevOps tools. So Cody, first, tell us a little bit about yourself.
Sure, well, even before that, thank you for having me on. I'm a huge fan of the podcast and what you're doing here, really giving voices to the mainframers at Broadcom. It's been enjoyable to watch.
Thank you.
Yeah, I mean, a little bit about my story. So again, Cody Giardinello, coming right out of college, 2014, joined CA Technologies, really didn't know much about mainframe at all, which kind of, you know, I've heard that story many times now.
Yes.
But, you know, didn't know much about mainframe, but I found kind of a neat, you know, niche, right? It was, it's a community, and everybody's just so passionate, and I kind of never left. So that's, you know, since then I've worked on a variety of different products as a software engineer. You know, I've really been interested in low level programming, you know, high level assembler, but then I've done even, you know, more distributed language, work in TypeScript and Python, you know, staying busy.
It's kind of a characteristic of a lot of the people we work with in Broadcom. They kind of start out in one area and then gradually they come to be kind of experts across the board.
Yeah, and there's so much to learn in every different discipline, whether it's, you know, product management and product ownership. That's kind of what I've most recently learned in my role as an engineering manager is, you know, there's kind of a business within the business. I was very much focused heads down. Some days I could spend without even talking to anybody with my headphones on. Now I'm in a completely different role and it's opened my eyes in many different ways.
Oh, certainly. So you are an engineering supervisor for Ops MVS and MIM, correct?
You got it.
So can you tell us just a little kind of a broad overview of those products?
Absolutely. So Ops MVS is it's an automation toolkit. Out of the box, you know, we kind of like to say it does very little, but that's because, you know, it's highly customizable. You get to solve your business problems the way that makes sense for you using our tools that we support. Think like system state manager, keeping your started tasks up and running in the right proper order or shutdown, or our automated operations facility, which is more rule-based actions. Basically think simulating anything an operator would do looking at a console. You can program automation to do it for you.
Okay.
And then MIM is primarily serialization. Think like, you know, serialization of DASD, of consoles and tape. It's very much an extension of ZOS as an operating system. The kind of complement is GRS, but it's on a much larger scale. It's sharing data a little bit differently.
Okay. And especially Ops MVS kind of integrates or is a important part of the Watchtower platform, right?
Absolutely. I mean, when you think, you know, Watchtower, observability, any events that are being generated on the mainframe, on ZOS, are originating and being captured by Ops MVS. So we're hooked right in there at the lowest levels, seeing the events as they happen. And so when we have that kind of root level control, we're able to, you know, do things like sending alerts from that event, whether it be a hardware event or an abend. You can write automation to then send an alert up to Watchtower, which, you know, opens things up to those other personas that are not watching the mainframe, that might not have that access. but they're able to view things kind of at that bird's eye view.
So it's definitely a cornerstone then of Watchtower.
Yep. Anything event-oriented and action-taking is happening through OpsMVS.
Obviously, we often talk about products and kind of the overarching goals and what things they do for customers. I actually want to dive deeper because you're an engineering supervisor. So while you are keen on reaching customer expectations, helping the team bring features to them, etc., you're actually quite focused on the team's efficiency and how they are able to bring that value to customers faster. So I'm just curious, some of the things that you've been working on or have implemented to help the team, maybe some of our DevOps tools, maybe some custom things, because no matter what the examples are, they'll help our customers as well. And maybe what are some of the things in your kind of roadmap?
Such a great question, and you're absolutely right. You know, we're programmers, so we want to, you know, work more efficiently as well. So our problems aren't unlike our customers. The first one that pops out to me is, most recently we've published our VS Code extension. That's our OpsRex VS Code extension. You know, bringing all of that native VS Code experience that you would have in VS Code, you know, bringing all of those OpsMVS capabilities to the table. You know, yes, ISPF has its role in mainframe development, but people want to use VS Code, and there's no question about that today. So being able to write rules, getting syntax highlighting, inline documentation, I mean, it's just a very seamless experience. And lately, we've really been putting a lot of work into expanding those functionalities.
Okay.
In the past, we've gone down paths of building web UIs to kind of present mainframe data more comfortably. We're finding that VS Code actually is a really great place for a lot of that information. So that's in development and a lot more to come there.
That's excellent. And so what about the developers in your team? So how do they achieve, right, taking something like a VS Code extension to market?
Yeah, so it's, the software delivery lifecycle has many different phases. I like to think of it, as kind of a research, prototype, implement, and kind of distribute, validate.
Yeah.
But when I explain it like that, it sounds a lot like waterfall, but it's way more agile than that. You know, we're regularly soliciting customer feedback. We're getting validation at our validation calls. And then we're also doing a lot of internal validation.
Yeah.
Getting feedback from some of our own subject matter experts to say, yes, we're on the right path. So there's a lot of those components of it, but it's in a shorter life cycle where if we fail quickly and we can pivot.
Definitely, definitely. And do you guys, in your teams, do you take advantage of some of our DevOps tools to kind of make the daily tasks easier?
Absolutely, yeah. So I've got Endeavor Bridge for Git set up, syncing our code, mirroring it, which, having that access is so important. Being able to view listings, again, in VS Code, it's a very natural experience. So having that as an option has been huge. Now, certainly have our tried and true Endeavor green screen developers.
Of course.
And, it's kind of like what we said earlier. Developers are going to choose the tools that make sense for them. It's about providing many options. So while VS Code might be a natural experience for someone, it might not be for someone else.
No, of course. No, and that's the message we preach, and it's really nice to hear about internal teams, right, taking advantage of Bridge for Git or other people continuing what they're doing because everything stays in sync. So obviously we're here at MTE. It's been great. What are you presenting this week, actually?
Yeah, so did you notice something here? Or?
We have a super fan in our midst.
Come on, I couldn't come empty.
Oh my gosh, that is amazing.
This one's
amazing.
This one's for you.
Oh my goodness.
I got you one too. But
oh my goodness.
When you're this big, you got to have your face on a mug. No, really. You guys have been doing an awesome thing for the mainframe space, and it's a thank you.
This is the greatest thing ever.
You ever have your face on a mug?
Look at this. Oh my gosh. We can talk about absolutely anything you want. And anytime, we're going to have a whole series dedicated to Cody Giardinello now.
I may not always have gifts, but really, I was excited to present with you. So.
Oh my God. Well, I'm Speechless. All right, but the show has to go on. Oh my God. I'll just hug this. All right, anyway.
What was the question?
No. Putting the spotlight on you. What are you presenting this week as part of MTE?
Yes. So again, as I've transitioned into kind of a management role, I have been determined to stay on my keyboard to continue programming. Yeah. And so that means continually learning. And so I've put a lot of effort recently into learning what's going on with Ansible.
Okay.
And Ansible is, you know, it's very well adopted and used in the distributed space, but not so much in mainframe. And IBM and Broadcom is investing heavily there. Yep. So I found some interesting use cases there, and I'm excited to kind of explore those. And also a bit of a tutorial, too. I want to make it easy for folks. Let's leave knowing that you can implement something pretty quickly.
That's awesome. And actually, that's something that we should follow up on, because in my team, we're working on the next evolution of team build, which will have some deployment capabilities. And while you can use what we're calling DZ internally to actually help orchestrate some things, it's meant to be able to be run from Ansible playbooks as well. So we could fit into that use case.
Let's do it.
That's awesome. Cody, you're amazing. Oh my gosh. The real star of the show and among our fandom. Oh my goodness. Cody, thanks so much for joining us.
It's a pleasure. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
I had given so much thought on
that. Was so good when you brought it up. I was like, what? No.
Well, I asked Lukas, I'm like, is it a table up view? Because I had it here. Trust me, I put way too much thought into this.
Now I will use a personalized mug in the office.
Good.
I've never used one, but this is the best coffee I've ever had.
Cheers.
Cheers.